Five new species and subspecies of birds have been discovered by researchers from the National University of Singapore and the Indonesia Institute of Sciences, and some of their habitats have been destroyed.
Now, the birds were found in three small island groups off Sulawesi, Indonesia. Extensive fieldwork was conducted on the less explored islands that had poor accessibility. The team was led by Dr. Frank Rheindt from NUS. And Dr. Rheindt was from NUS Faculty of Science, joins us now in studio to tell us more about it. Fascinating and exciting as well. Five new songbird species, five new subspecies as well. Tell us what led you to find them.
The Indonesian archipelago has about 20,000 islands, so you might think, where are the islands that have a higher potential for species discovery? Mm-hmm. In our case, we concentrated on islands that are surrounded by deep sea, because that means that these islands are particularly isolated and are likely to have a high level of endemism, endemic species that are not shared with anywhere else on Earth. Mm-hmm. So a good example for that would be, a counterexample would be Singapore. While we perceive Singapore to be an island, more often than not, it's not an island. Over the last 2 million years, Singapore has been part of the Asian mainland for about 80% of the time, because during ice ages, the sea level goes down, and Singapore gets connected to the Asian mainland and actually also to the Indonesian side on both sides. So it's only the islands surrounded by deep sea that are truly islands in the biogeographic sense and have a lot of endemic species.
Right. So these subspecies and species that you found, tell us a little bit about the habitat that they're in. Because if you say they're surrounded by deep sea, very inaccessible, how did you guys get there, and you know, what did you have to deal with to hear or see these birds?
Right. So even though we were talking about the sea a whole lot just now, all of these, or 9 out of the 10 new birds, are actually montane in distribution. They live in the highlands of the islands of Taliabu and Peleng, and they live in cloud forest. They range from very colorful ones, such as honey eaters, bright scarlet red, that feed on nectar and flowers, to very inconspicuous brown denizens of the undergrowth, such as the grasshopper warbler with its insect-like song. And these islands are quite isolated. The largest island of discovery was Taliabu. It's probably the largest island in Indonesia that does not have an airport, no regular passenger ferries going there, so the human communities there are quite isolated as well.
How did you manage to find these birds? I'm curious. Is it by sound, by sight?
A lot of patience.
A lot of patience. And they're not big birds, right? Yeah. They're actually quite small. They're small in size.
That's right. Most of them are quite small songbirds. The majority of them, actually, a number of them were found by sound first. So the grasshopper warbler is a case in point. I heard it many days before I first got to see it. I heard the insect-like vocalization, and I knew that I was going to have to stick around and try and see it, but it took a long time because it's so shy.
And what are we looking at here on the screen? What bird is that?
This is the Taliabu myzomela. It's a type of honey eater. I mentioned it earlier. This is a leaf warbler. So these are very inconspicuous as well, but they're in the canopy. They have this one we opted to call after its beautiful voice. And this is the grasshopper warbler just now, and an aerial shot of the area there.
It does look incredibly dense and untouched. I suppose we should be take some heart from that their habitat seems to be sort of left alone. Are there concerns that might not always be the case?
There are grave concerns. The aerial shot that you saw is the exception. About 80% of the island of Taliabu has been logged multiple times over by logging companies. And even if we now go out there and try to preserve the last patches of habitat that are still there, there are the sinister effects of climate change. All these birds are montane birds. They only have about a narrow belt of 300 elevational meters. With warming temperatures, elevational zones creep up the mountain, and there's nowhere else to go up the mountain in future decades. Droughts and wildfires have set in, similar to what you just showed from Australia. The largest wildfires in human memory just 2 decades ago in Taliabu. So in the future, the pessimist in me tells me that some of these birds might not survive another 3 or 4 decades despite our best attempts, unless human communities around the world effect dramatic changes.
And what would those changes be, and how do you save them?
Reining in emissions, changing the course of climate change, and of course combating habitat loss and forest loss.
And does that then increase sort of the urgency perhaps to try and discover any more that are out there before it becomes too late?
I think so. Our world now needs a new impetus, a resurgence of biodiversity discovery. The golden era, the heydays of biodiversity discovery, were in the late 19th century and early 20th century, and after that there was a big gap. So we need more efforts in this respect to know where the biodiversity is at.
Okay, well, thank you so much for coming in and sharing this with us. Fascinating stuff, Dr. Frank Rheindt from NUS Faculty of Science.
Thank you very much.